everyone. I'm not conducting, I'm only the pre-concert entertainment. Welcome to the second orchestra concert. I have been called to the quota office as interim associate dean, and it's a different bargaining unit, so I may not conduct the orchestra for the time while I do that. So we're very happy to have very able hands this evening. We're delighted to have Dr. Jacob Sustaita, who is the assistant conductor of Pacific Symphony, and he has college teaching experience, so we're very delighted to have him on the campus for the remainder of this and most likely the next semester. And he will talk a little bit about the second half. The first half is going to be conducted by my student Apostolia, who started her tenure as a conducting student this fall. Now, the reason why we are divided up into two chamber orchestras has to do with the COVID protocols. There have been some new protocols that came down on September 19th, and we squeaked by with our last orchestra concert, Shostakovich 10, in the big hall just before they went in effect. So now we have to have mandatory distance between all winds and brass of 6 feet. So we can't fit a large orchestra, not here and not in CPAC either. So that's why for now we're dividing into two chamber orchestras and we do the best we can. There's a lot of merit that comes from doing smaller repertoire where the orchestra trains to listen. So it's just a different kind of repertoire we're going to do for the next few concerts. So Dr. Sustaita will talk about the second half. The first half, you will hear a very rarely heard early symphony by Schubert, number 3. It is very Mozartian in its sort of transparent lines. It's not a large orchestration. Very juvenile, joyful Schubert, and it's also not very long, so you will undoubtedly enjoy that piece. Now the second piece on the first half, the Hiawatha suite, is very special. That was composed by Samuel Coleridge-Taylor, who is a composer of color, born in England, and reached fame through the Hiawatha Ballet that he toured the United States and all over the world. This suite is extracted from the ballet. Unfortunately, there are parts available, but no full score. So no orchestra, to my knowledge, has performed this since the 1920s. We were able to get the parts, and through the able help of an alum, Nate Trunereau, who is in the audience. You want to wave at people? Yeah. It was a ginormous undertaking. We scanned all the parts, sent it to him, and he produced the full score. That is really necessary for the conductor to do any sort of meaningful rehearsal. And we only found one mistake, right? It was really amazing. I mean, it's so exact. So we're very happy that Nate put that together. And that undoubtedly is going to be a great piece. You'll probably never hear it again because it's performed so rarely. For all I know, this is the California premiere. So thank you for coming, and please join me in welcoming Apostolia Nikouli.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. begin with this mask on, I think you can hear me, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, good. And now try to talk as loud as possible. I just want to say thank you to all of you and to all the amazing musicians on the stage for inviting me here. It's been an incredible couple of weeks and a few rehearsals leading up to this concert. And we still have one more to go. My name is Jacob Sustaita. I'm the new assistant conductor for Pacific Symphony. And when I got the call to come here, I jumped on it. Before I moved to California, I was a university professor for 5 years. So this really is like coming home. It's what I love doing. Collegiate level music making, I think, is where I belong. But don't tell my boss that. You're going to hear two really fantastic works that couldn't be more different in this half of the concert. Mozart Symphony No. 39, and then the William Grant Still Panama Dances. So Mozart was 32 when he wrote this piece in 1788. We know he won't last very long. He passes away at 35 a couple years later. This is the beginning of the end, you could say. This is the last of his three symphonies, 39, 40, and 41. We don't know a lot of the details about, did he hear it, did he not hear it? He probably heard it. He probably heard all three of them. But, you know, we won't get into the semantics of all that. They're different, though. He wrote them in a way freely. This was an artist of the highest caliber just writing music. He didn't have to dedicate it to anybody. It wasn't for an occasion. Nobody was paying him to do this. This is an artist doing what an artist does. And you are going to hear the most fantastic sounds. It starts with a slow introduction, which is not common for Mozart. He has a few of them, but it, you know, for the time, there's no big deal. But this introduction is like a Beethoven introduction. It's long, it's got different rhythms, it's got some incredible dissonance in the harmony that actually Beethoven will steal for his Eroica symphony, the exact same notes, just kind of voiced in a little different way for even more impact. And there's actually a lot of connection between this symphony in E-flat and Beethoven's Eroica, you know, that he dedicated to Napoleon Bonaparte and then, of course, erased his name off the title page. The first movement after the introduction is in 3-4, just like the Eroica Symphony. And just like the Eroica Symphony in E-flat, starts with the theme played softly, which is also unique, to have the opening theme not full glory. And we get there eventually. But I think you'll really enjoy all the bombastic fireworks that Mozart has in store for us. The other interesting thing about this symphony is there are no oboes, which again is not uncommon, but because it has clarinet rather than oboe, you will hear the clarinets in all of their glory in the trio of the third movement, as if a concerto for clarinet suddenly emerges in the trio. Then the finale is one of the most wicked violin excerpts there is. You can ask them later. There's a theme that starts this finale. And unlike Mozart's finales, there's only one theme, really, throughout this movement. I mean, there's little variations, but it's like this incessant theme cannot get out of Mozart's head. In fact, so much so that at the end of the finale, there are no final chords that you would expect in a symphony. It's the theme repeated twice as if to say, you're not getting away from me, buddy. And a real tour de force for orchestra. So I think you're going to enjoy this symphony. Then after that, I want you to take a trip to the Caribbean. Relax. I was telling the orchestra earlier, imagine you have a mojito or something exotic and tropical. A tiki drink would be good. Because William Grant Still, that was his destination for us, to take us to the Caribbean. Four dances. The inner dances are more Spanish influenced, and the two outer dances are more Afro-American influenced with their rhythms, and it's just a really sweet set of songs for string orchestra, and I hope you enjoy. Again, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure and an honor to be here and work with these amazing musicians that you see behind me. I look forward to our next concert, and I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you.